Let's look at our passage this morning. A little bit of a lengthier passage. It's 1 Timothy chapter 5, and we'll start in verse 3 and read to verse 16. That passage says this: "Honor widows who are really widows. But if any widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show piety at home and to repay their parents. For this is good and acceptable before God. Now she who is really a widow and left alone trusts in God and continues in supplications and prayers night and day. But she who lives in pleasure is dead while she lives. And these things command that they may be blameless. But if anyone does not provide for his own, and especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Do not let a widow under 60 years old be taken into the number, and not unless she has been the wife of one man, well reported for good works, if she has brought up children, if she has lodged strangers, if she has washed the saints' feet, if she has received the afflicted, if she has diligently followed every good work. But refuse the younger widows, for when they have begun to grow wanton against Christ, they desire to marry, having condemnation because they have cast off their first faith. And besides, they learn to be idle, wandering about from house to house, not only idle, but also gossips and busybodies, saying things which they ought not. Therefore, I desire that the younger widows marry, bear children, manage the house, give no opportunity to the adversary to speak reproachfully. For some have already turned aside after Satan. If any believing man or woman has widows, let them relieve them, and do not let the church be burdened, that may relieve those who are really widows." Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for your word, your precious word, that you provide for us, that we might take it and study it, to understand it. Because, Father, here we have before us this morning your words of life. Those words that just refresh our souls, uplift us, encourage us to live our lives as we ought. We thank you for that, and we just praise your name that we are so privileged to have your word so abundantly in this nation. Father, we just pray that you bless the reading of your word this morning and the study of it. And Father, may our souls be refreshed. And may you receive all the honor and all the praise. We pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. In our society today, we have some unique dynamics that in the history of mankind, really, we haven't seen before, at least to our knowledge, in any kind of historical documentation. And that's just the fact that we have some pretty amazing medical advances that have gone on just within the last century or even two, dating all the way back to the 1800s, some pretty impressive things that have happened in the medical community. And essentially what has happened is the lives of the people of this world have become much longer than they were before. And because of that, there are some unique situations that arise. And one of those is just the fact that because people live longer today, we have more people who are older today than we have in the past. And because of that, our society itself has needed to look into options as to how to deal with a generation that in the past, by and large, would pass off the scene much earlier than they do today. And the fact is, we have a blessedness in the fact that we have older people now with us. Whereas in the past, there was a lot of wisdom that was lost Because people died much earlier, now we have people around who can tell us stories of things that we would never have heard firsthand. But that medical technology has advanced so much so that we have those people with us. But at the same time, there is also, it's interesting to note, that there's also an added burden with that. Not that older people are burdens, that's not what I'm saying, but there is an added burden to society. In that people who are older, I mean, face it, right? Those of you who drive older cars know what I'm talking about. As you drive your car, and as it gets older, it ages. Pretty soon, it starts getting, right, a little slower, a little sluggish, and then horror of all horrors, parts start falling off, right? And then suddenly, at some point in time, it just doesn't want to move anymore. What a great illustration of us, right? As we get older, we start getting a little more tired and a little harder to get out of bed in the morning. Things start aching that, you know, didn't ache before. And it's just, you know, life just becomes a little more challenging. Not that it can't be lived, but it just becomes a little more challenging. And that's because in this world that we live in, as we get older, we start to fall apart. How else can we say it? We can't put it any more delicately than that. That's essentially what happens. And so with older age, there comes new and daunting tasks that must be tackled. And really, I think if our society, I shouldn't say I think, let me say more positively. I know that if our society looked at what the Bible said about many issues, things would be a little simpler. Because the Bible tells us what we need to do. And in fact, we actually started the subject the last couple weeks. It may not seem like it. Really, verses 1 and 2 of chapter 5 are an introduction to this section. And let me just, to refresh your memories, let me go ahead and just read those for you. It says this, "Do not rebuke an older man, but exhort him as a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters, with all purity." So we're talking about respect for all, no matter who they are in the church. Now, specifically, this is referring to adults, adult members of the church. Those who are younger, obviously, they're under the tutelage of their parents. And so that's a little bit of a different situation. But as far as adult members of the church community are concerned, these first two verses apply to it, and specifically to older members, because Paul brings out the fact specifically that older members are to be respected in a much greater way, in a way that society deems is appropriate, and even to a certain extent biblically is appropriate. And so Paul begins the idea of honoring those who are older there in verses 1 and 2. And when we get to verse 3, it makes sense. Okay, Paul just said, do not rebuke an older man, but exhort him as a father. And then in verse 2, he said, older women, exhort them as mothers. And so it makes sense to move into verse 3, honor widows who are really widows. And so to understand the obligations that are mentioned here, as far as the older members of the church community, we need go no further than the Bible itself. And unfortunately, it seems like the church today does everything but go to the Bible to solve problems. The fact is, that's where we need to go first. Whether it's personal problems in our own lives, or whether or not it's problems in the church or issues in the church, we need to go to the Word of God. And the only reason I say that is because I was surprised by even my study of this passage, how some commentators on this passage, they went to the Bible, of course, but they more specifically interpreted the Bible through church history. And I was thinking, okay, church history is wonderful. We can learn from history. I'm a history buff. I love history. But it's not scripture. It's not the same thing. We need go no further than the Word of God to determine, okay, what do we do with older members in our church? How do we help specifically widows in the church, which is what this passage is all about? And there is one idea behind this whole thing, and that's taking care of widows in the church. It's not several different subjects. One person suggested, well, this passage of Scripture is actually talking about several different subjects in regard to widows. But it's not. It's referring to helping widows from the beginning to the ending. Look at verse 3 and 4. I mean, it's obvious we're talking about helping widows, right? When you get to verses 15 and 16, or pardon me, 14, 15, and 16, you find out, once again, Paul is talking about helping widows. Some people try to suggest in this passage that, well, maybe this was just referring, part of this was actually just referring to, some kind of a church position, where widows were working in the church as kind of like you have deacons and you have elders and then you have widows. Well, I don't think that's what's going on here. What's being referred to here by Paul is the church's responsibility in regard to taking care of those who need to be taken care of, in a general sense, and more in a more specific sense, to take care of women in the church who need it. And so that's what's going on here. Just a cursory reading of that seems pretty obvious, but the fact is there are a lot of misconceptions in regard to this passage of Scripture on what Paul is talking about. And so this is an extremely important passage of Scripture, mainly because of what we just talked about. Because we do have a society that is aging because of medical advancements. And so the church is going to have some interesting dilemmas in the near future if it doesn't figure out what it needs to do in regard to what we're looking at here. So this is an extremely relevant and very important passage of Scripture. And so let's take a look at it this morning. Okay? Because we need to know how to love one another. It starts right here. It starts with the older members of the church. And so first of all, we're going to look at the obvious fact that Paul states here, that the church must support widows. Okay, we find that in verses 3 and 7. And we'll actually kind of jump around here a little bit because Paul jumps around in his thought patterns here. That's one thing I love about Paul. He liked to sometimes go off on bunny trails. And so it makes me feel a lot better about myself when I'm preaching and I go off on a bunny trail like I just did just now. So Paul did it. So obviously there's nothing wrong with that. But we're going to look at this verses 3 and 7. Let me go ahead and just read those very quickly for you. Honor widows who are really widows. And then we skip down to verse 7. It says this, "And these things command that they may be blameless." Now, we'll look at that in just a moment, who is Paul is talking to in regard to being blameless there. But the main thrust of what Paul is saying is there in verse 3, right? Honor widows who are really widows. Well, what does it mean? What does that mean? What does it mean especially to honor widows? Does that mean when they walk into a room, you step aside and let them go through the door first? Is that what we're referring to? Well, actually, that word, their honor, can mean that. In the original language, that was one of the shades of meaning of that word, that it was to show proper respect. And then, once again, going back to verses 1 and 2 there, where it talks about, especially verse 2, where it talks about exhorting older women as mothers, showing proper respect. That's what this word can mean. Too often in the church, we turn our noses up at certain groups of people because we don't necessarily relate to them. Maybe they're out of our age group. Or here's another one. Maybe they're out of our financial group. Maybe they're different. They make a different amount of money. Maybe they're not in the same stage of life that we are. Whatever it is, we have to be very, very careful that we are not ignoring a certain group of people just because we don't feel like we relate to them. Folks, we've got the greatest relation the world has ever seen. And that's the fact that we are brothers and sisters in God through Jesus Christ. We're family. I mean, how in the world can you make it more important than that, right? We are family. of one another. And so we need to be taking care of each other's needs. But unfortunately, and I've been in churches like this, may I say maybe a little more upscale churches, where you walk in, and if you're not dressed the same way that everyone else is, well, you just kind of get ignored. Because, well, you know, maybe you have a different economic status, or maybe you're just in a different stage of life or something of that nature. The church should never be that way. The church should never be a group of snobs. How much more pointed can I put it than that? Because unfortunately, we sometimes, as Christians, are snobs. We take a look at someone, and we don't like the way that they look, and so we don't interact with them. Shame on us. Shame on us. Because we are to take care of one another, no matter what the situation. And so, God in His Word here singles out widows to be honored. But the word honor actually goes a little farther than that. These women who are described as widows here are to be given not just a special place, not just an important place of respect, but they're also to be given what they need to survive, just as all others in the church survive. Although the word honor does mean to show respect, it goes actually further than that. I don't think in this case that it should be restricted to just stepping aside and letting someone older go through the door first. I don't think that's necessarily the only thing that Paul had in mind, although I think he had that in mind here. But the word honor can also mean to help with financial needs. Okay, we see that. Jesus was speaking to the Pharisees in Matthew chapter 15, verses 1 through 6. And let me read that passage for you very quickly. It says this: "Then the scribes and Pharisees who were from Jerusalem came to Jesus, saying, 'Why do your disciples transgress the traditions of the elders? For they do not wash their hands when they eat bread.' He answered and said to them, 'Why do you also transgress the commandments of God because of your tradition? For God commanded, saying, "Honor your father and your mother, and he who curses father or mother, let him be put to death. But you say, whoever says to his father or mother, "Whatever profit you might have received from me is a gift to God," then he need not honor his father or mother. Thus you have made the commandment of God of no effect by your tradition." So what was going on here was the Pharisees were going, you know, I don't want to take care of my aging parents because, man, they're just too much of a burden. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a rule that says, if I play this just the right way, if I give my entire life to God, then I just can sweep them aside and they're on their own. That's what the Pharisees were doing. And Jesus made it very clear, look, what do you think the term honor your father and mother meant? It meant take care of them. Whatever needs they have later in life, you take care of those. Now, does that mean financial needs as well? Absolutely. Who wants to see their parents starve? But to show you how hard-hearted the Pharisees were in Jesus' day, they were just standing around watching their parents starve to death while they filled their pockets with gold, while they increased in power. They did all that. They exploited that loophole, if we can call it that, of giving everything to God so that they didn't have to take care of their parents. But notice, several times the word honor is used in there. In that case, honor is not just referring to respect, but is also referring to what? Providing for financial needs, right? And so that I truly believe is what's going on in our passage. So when Paul says honor widows, he's saying take care of them, whatever needs. Now there are more needs than just financial needs, right? There are other needs that need to be done. Sometimes, you know, shoveling snow or something of that nature to help out people, that is included in the idea of honor. But if you read on this passage, Paul makes it very clear, doesn't he, that this is talking about financial needs. And so Paul is saying to the church, he's saying to Timothy, to tell the church, look, you need to take care of widows, whatever their needs, even if it is financial. And that was really quite a statement by Paul, because even in that day and age, the church didn't really have a lot of money. It didn't. In fact, so much so that the Jerusalem church was so poor that other churches around had to actually send money to Jerusalem to help the people there. And now, obviously, we're not talking about the Jerusalem church here, but that's just kind of a microcosm of what the church was like in that day and age. The church was not rich. In fact, about during this time, the church was starting to be persecuted. But God still says in His Word, take care of those who need it. That's quite a statement, isn't it? Now, here we are in the 21st century, and we've got more money than we know what to do with, whether we think so or not. We may groan and moan about being poor, but really, folks, we have more now than any other church in the history of the church, right back to the first century. And so today, we really have no excuse to ignore this principle. And so, once again, it's relevant for today. But these women, we are to help them, not just in the sense that obviously there is a need there and we must do that, but really they need it to live. Okay? Last time I checked, people need food to live, right? If you don't get food, you starve to death. If you don't get proper hydration, you die. The basic needs of life must be met for people to live. Now, if there is a group of people who cannot provide for themselves, who will? The answer that Paul gives here is the church. Who are these women? Well, they are women who have been abandoned. The English word widow does not mean what, or the English word widow, pardon me, does not mean what Paul wrote as widow here. Our idea of a widow is what? Yeah, right. A woman whose husband has died. And that's what we think of. But actually, the Greek word was much less restricted in meaning. The word meant any woman who had been abandoned, whether in death, by divorce, or just simply left alone by her husband. And so when Paul was referring to these women in the church, he wasn't just referring to women who had lost their husbands, although that was included in it. But Paul was saying that any woman in need, any woman who had been abandoned by the breadwinner. And remember that time. That was a, if I can put it this way, a very male-dominated time. And so the breadwinner was the man. If a woman's husband died or left her in some way, whether divorce or some other way, she had no way to take care of herself. And you know what? There were people in that day and age, especially women, who starved to death. A sad but true fact of that time. And so what does Paul say here? The church should never be accused of allowing its own to starve to death. Take care of anybody who needs to be taken care of. These women had no means of support, and so therefore the church needed to become their means of support. But not just that, it goes even beyond that, in that this is just absolutely a command. Paul does not say to the church here, okay, take care of widows if you're rich. Take care of widows if you feel like it. Take care of widows if it's not snowy outside. You know, that's not what Paul says. Look at what verse 7 says. And these things command. Yeah, you know what that word command in the Greek means? Command. That's what it means. It means do it. It means there is no other option here. You take care of widows no matter what. The church was commanded to take care of them. And through this, it brought legitimacy to the church. Because if the church was just simply another organization that watched its own die, they would be just like anyone else. And actually, even in that time, that was a shame, even in the secular community. The world felt it was wrong to allow your parents, to allow the older generation to die such horrible deaths. If the church did that, shame on the church. Because we should be a step above the world. We should be steps above the world, right? Because we have Christ. We're different. We should love one another intensely. And so Paul's command here is take care of widows. Now that may seem cut and dry. That may seem pretty easy. Okay, so okay, take care of widows. We'll just take care of all the widows that are in the church. But Paul says, wait, stop. Let me give you some further instructions here. And this is where it gets a little sticky, because I've had conversations with people and they've said, this person needs to be taken care of because they are a widow. But before we determine that, once again, we need to go to the Word of God and see what it says. Because Paul restricts the idea here. He doesn't just say any widow that needs help. He gives us some further principles. And so then the church next must determine which widows are qualified for support. And that's essentially the first eight verses here that we look at give us further instruction on what a widow should be. How does she qualify for support? And this is an interesting passage of Scripture, especially when you get to verse 9, and we'll look at this in just a little bit, but they actually had lists of widows. They actually had an enrollment for women who were specifically given support, who qualified for support from the church. And so who are these women? What did they look like? Well, let's look at them. Let's see what Paul considered women who were qualified to be called widows in the church. And as you can see at the beginning of this, it says those who are really widows. So who are really widows? Well, number one, this is a woman who must qualify according not just to the standards that Paul has already given in the word itself, but even more so. She must be a woman who is completely and totally destitute. We talked about that. But not just completely destitute, but she has absolutely no financial recourse at all. Okay, she can't go down to the welfare office and pick up food stamps. She can't do that. She doesn't have any kind of family to lean upon. She has no hope. This is a woman who is completely hopeless in life. She has nowhere else to go. She also must be one who has absolutely no family in any regard. And this means extended family or family that is close. The church family becomes her family. Because you see, the church is only as strong as the families that are in it. And that's true. We don't quite understand that, unfortunately, today, because we live in a society where families are being torn apart, aren't they? On a regular basis, it's sad to see divorce in our nation. It's a sad reality, a reality nonetheless, but it's a sad reality. It's sad to see what we even have a term for it now. It's called dysfunctional families. I mean, what society gets so degraded that it actually comes up with a term for dysfunctional families? And we call them dysfunctional families. But there are so many in this nation that we have to coin a term for it. It's no wonder that the church is in the state that it is, because when you see when you look at the church, you see what it's made out of. It's made out of the same components as the world out there. The world, the family is a mess. Maybe the church isn't quite as bad, but it's not far behind. You want a weak, a sickly church? Just allow the families, the family units, the physical families to fall apart. And that's the reason why God was so specific in His Word, the type of leaders that were to lead the church. They were to be ones who were very, very careful, to rule their houses well, to rule their families well. A similar situation here in regard to widows. When her family is gone, when it has fallen apart, whether through abandonment, through death, whatever it is, when she comes to the point where she has no one else, then what she does is she turns from her physical family to her spiritual family, her church family. But Paul says, but hold on, in verse 4, if a widow has any children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show piety at home and to repay their parents, for this is good and acceptable before God. And so if a woman has family, they are to first take care of her. Notice it's children and grandchildren. This is a couple generations. And once again, because of what has happened in our world today, the family not doing what it's supposed to be doing, we don't necessarily understand the idea. We think of parents, aging parents, as the responsibility of their sons and daughters, their children. But God's word makes it very clear that it's the responsibility of everyone. And in fact, later in the passage, we find that Paul makes it even more clear that it's not just children and grandchildren, it's everyone. Folks, the family unit, the physical family unit, is a unit. It's just that. Everybody takes care of one another. But see, we're too mobile today, aren't we? We move from here to there and all over the place. And what happens? We lose track of one another, don't we? We even sometimes lose a connection to our own families. I've shared before that my mom sometimes calls. And, you know, I can tell when she's saying, Bill, you're not calling enough, by, oh, I was just missing you. Yeah, well, I know what that means. And that's true. She was missing me, and I should call more often because I need to have that connection with my family. That's what Paul is saying here. Families, the physical family unit within the church, needs to take care of their own before the church steps in. But not only that, this woman, this widow, as she is defined here, must be a strong woman of faith. And I guess this goes without saying, but here's what Paul wrote. Here's what God gave us in his word. He says this, now she who is really a widow and left alone trusts in God and continues in supplications and prayers night and day. But she who lives in pleasure is dead while she lives. Okay, Paul's point here is the fact that this needs to be a woman who is on top of her spiritual life. Notice he says she must pray night and day. Okay, that doesn't mean that every waking moment she's got her head bowed and she's praying. The point there that he's making is the fact that this woman has an active prayer life. She is a woman who is spiritually strong. When others are having a bad day, she is so spiritually strong that even though she is destitute, even though she has no one, even though she has nothing, she knows she serves a purpose in the church. And she knows she has to keep her spiritual life active. Why? Because she realizes that her primary source of income is not here on this earth, but is in heaven, is God. And by the way, that's a lesson we can all learn, isn't it? That's a lesson we need to learn, to be more dependent on God. But that's what this woman is like. That's who she is. She's a woman who doesn't look out and go, oh, what am I going to do? She looks out and sees a dire situation. She sees her situation. She could panic at this point in time, but she doesn't. She says, my strength comes from my God. My hope comes from Him. And friends, what a wonderful example for us in the church to follow, to be those who constantly look to our God for help. But I find this interesting because the implication of this woman being a woman who is totally dependent upon God, she does not worry about anything. When she needs something, she goes in prayer to God. The implication of this is she doesn't see the church as a source of income. This is not a woman who walks into the church and demands that she be paid to live. That's not the attitude. The attitude is, my God will supply all my needs. If the church is His to use for that to happen, so be it. But God will provide. Do you see how this woman is faithful through and through? She's a strong believer in every single way. There's no chink in her spiritual armor. And she's a woman that everyone in the church can draw inspiration from, because we should all be exactly that way. She's not one who engages in pleasure, okay? And when we think of the word pleasure, we normally think of sexual pleasure, don't we? But that's not what's being referred to. This is actually the word leisure. That's what's being referred to here. This is not a woman of leisure. This is not a woman who sits around and eats bonbons and goes and plays out at the squash court, okay? That's not what's being referred to here. This is a woman who has taken care of her own responsibilities, not just in her own personal life, but also spiritually. She does not want to be a burden on anyone. But Paul's statement here is, she becomes the burden of the church because of her spiritual attitude. And then in the first part of verse 9 here, it says, do not let a widow under 60 years old be taken into the number. She must meet an age requirement to be a widow. She, in fact, first needs to be enrolled in the church as a widow. We talked about this. That phrase right there in verse 9 where it says be taken into the number is probably better expressed with the word enrolled. That's what's being referred to. In other words, there was a program in the first century church that took care of widows. And if you go to Acts chapter 6, you see that's exactly what was going on. There were problems in the church. If you go to Acts chapter 6, you know that, well, actually the widows were complaining, but it was because they weren't being taken care of properly. There was a problem in that church program. There was a problem with the way the churches in that day and age were taking care of widows. And so Paul here says that there needs to be a specific way that widows are taken care of. And it begins with her age. She can only be enrolled if she meets the age threshold, which here, as we see, is 60 years old. That's the threshold. Now, why that was chosen, that specific age was chosen, we do not know. God's word does not indicate to us why. We can surmise why some people, some cultures believe that at 60 years old, then the desire to marry just disappeared. I don't know, ladies. I have no clue if that's true or not. I'm not a lady. But one person suggested that. The fact is we don't know. This is what God put in His word, and so we just accept it as such. But the fact is, this woman was to be enrolled only if she met that age threshold. And then also, a very important idea here is found in the second part of verse 9. She must be honorable in her marriage. That's what the idea of being the wife of one man. Do you remember when we studied about the elder pastor position and how he was to be the husband of one wife? Same exact construct here. Same exact idea right here that's being referred to, just switched. This is not necessarily a woman who only had one husband. This is a woman who was so committed to the man that she was married to that it didn't matter what happened. She respected him in every single way. Now, if her husband abandoned her, or divorced her, there was recourse for that. Paul talks about that in other passages of Scripture. We don't have time this morning to go into that, unfortunately. I wish we did. It'd be a great back study to this. But the fact is, this woman was to be a one-man kind of woman. That's what the Greek means there. That's what the original language means. She is to be a one-man kind of woman, committed to her marriage. And that's an important aspect of spiritual life as well. Because what people don't realize, and I being a pastor have gotten to see this firsthand, marrying many people, but the fact is that when people stand up there, I don't think they realize fully what they are saying when they say, I do. They are committing themselves to each other. They are promising, okay, even beyond promising. They are making a solemn oath that they will fulfill their marriage vows. That's, when you put it that way, it sounds a lot heavier, doesn't it, than just simply, I do. But essentially, they are swearing before God that they will do what they say they are going to do. That's the type of woman this is. She is committed to keeping her word, especially being committed to her husband. This woman may have lost her husband in death. She may have been abandoned by an unbelieving husband and then remarried. But whatever the case, she is a woman of her word. And then she also must be strong in her Christian faith. Verse 10 says this, well reported for good works. And then Paul goes into a number of good works. Okay, so this is the summary. The first part of verse 10 is the summary. Well reported for good works. What are those good works? Well, number one, she was nurturing. That's actually the idea behind the phrase, if she has brought up children. It does not necessarily mean that she bore children in the sense that she was married and had children, but that she has a nurturing spirit. She has a nurturing attitude. In fact, that's what brought up means. It means to nurture there in that case. Not only is she nurturing, but she's hospitable. In other words, she takes care of everyone. This is a woman who never shies away from helping others when she can, when she is able to help. In fact, the idea of lodging strangers is kind of an odd idea to us in our day and age. Normally, when we go somewhere, we rent a car. Well, at least we do, because we've got old clunkers. So if we go on a long distance drive, then we get a rental car. And we normally also get a hotel or a motel. And for our family, it's normally the cheapest place we can find because that's just the way that we do it. We like to try to be as frugal as we can. In that day and age, they had places to stay, but they were few and far between. And in that culture, people would actually open up their homes to strangers and allow them in. You don't dare do that today. Things are a little different today than they were back then. But the fact is, that's what you did in that day and age. That showed your hospitality. It was rude to do anything less than that. And so this woman is not a woman who's rude. She does what is necessary, even to the extent of bringing strangers into her home. She also did the dirty work. I don't know of any other job, any job dirtier than the job of washing somebody's feet. I can't imagine that. I'm glad today we wash our own feet. We have showers, we have baths, we have all those wonderful accoutrements today that they did not have in that day and age. But in that day and age, because they walked, many people walked, if they could not afford some kind of other transportation, they walked, they wore sandals. Guess what happened to their feet? Their feet became sweaty and their feet became dirty and disgusting. And so it was necessary for a homeowner to make sure that when they invited someone into their home, that those feet were washed. This was a woman who made sure of that. Whether she did the task herself or whether she made sure that it was done, she made sure that people were taken care of, even the most menial tasks. She was not afraid to do the dirty work. And then number four, this is also a woman who gives to those in need no matter what the situation. Paul made it clear here that this woman took care of outstanding needs of anybody who needed them, anybody she came in contact with. For someone to be afflicted, which is the word there that we see, for anyone to be considered afflicted, it meant that they were in dire straits. It meant that they were in a situation where they had no other recourse. Sound familiar? It kind of sounds like the widow, right? So this woman was a woman who, in her lifetime, And by the way, all of these things are things that she did, that people documented, and they knew that she was this type of woman. That she was willing, no matter what, to take those who were afflicted in dire straits, who had no other recourse, and be the one to take care of them. And so you can see a little bit of irony here, can't you? You see that the woman who took care of everyone, now it's the church's responsibility to take care of her. Now it's the church's responsibility to say, okay, now she has done her work. She has done what she was supposed to do. She has done her Christian duty. Now let's take care of her. All these qualifications add up to just one fact, that widows who were enrolled in the church and should be enrolled in the church for help must serve a purpose in helping the church. Because there was a reason why. Did you notice all of those things were not just responsibilities, were not just spiritual responsibilities, but many of them were actually physical tasks, like washing feet, entertaining strangers, all of those things. Why do you think those were requirements for a widow? Number one, because it showed her spiritual mettle, right? But number two, because guess what? Women who came into the church who were helped ended up turning that around and helping in ways that they could in the church themselves. And this is just, once again, a microcosm of what the church is. There is never a member who does not serve a purpose. And that's the sad thing about our society. Our society today says, take older people and just shove them in a nursing home and just forget about them. But that's not the church. The church says, help them so that they can continue to be active members of the church. What an awesome organism the church is, isn't it? Our God has created a situation that is so perfect that even people that society says are just throwaway people are people who still do the work of the church. The church just makes sure that they're able to do that. And that's really the whole point of the passage up until this point in time. In fact, there are some who believe that this may have even been the office of what we already looked at, the office of deaconess. That these were the women who were taking care of the needs of the church. Because the church was taking care of them, they turned that around and helped with the church. But the point of all of this is the exciting idea that the church loves its people so much that there are no throwaway people at all in the church. These are definitely reasons to be taking care of widows. But remember, let's not miss the point though. Paul gave very specific principles here to qualify these women. Now he also gives principles to disqualify them, which sounds harsh, I know. But the fact is there were some that Paul said are women who are not, even though they may seem like they qualify as widows, they do not qualify as widows. We've run out of time, so we will look at this next week. There's still a lot to be seen here. But once again, let's not miss the point here, that the church is to take care of its own. We are a group of people that have been given so much, haven't we? I mean, think about what Jesus did on the cross. Once again, I know I harp on this all the time, but folks, I love harping on this. The fact is, our Savior, our Lord and Savior, gave everything for us. Hopefully, we have such a heart of love that we are willing to give back to one another, and especially those who need help the most in the church.